Welcome to the Michael Cooley podcast on Rethinking Leadership. In these episodes, we will look at leadership with a fresh perspective and take your leadership effectiveness to the next level. For more information, go to cooleyinstitute.com and follow Michael's continuous learning insights on social media.
Listen, power is a dangerous thing, positively and negatively. You can't underestimate power. I mean, how can you even underestimate power? Power makes things move. So when you're dealing with power, the dynamics of power come into play. I'll translate how that is an answer to what you're saying, what you're asking. When you exercise leadership, or when you're in a position of authority, that place gives you power, because you get people's attention, and that's powerful. When you connect with people at a deep level, that gives you power, because people, as a result of the connection, especially if is an authentic connection, people surrender to you, they trust you, that gives you power. When people choose you or elect you or commission you or contract you to do a certain task, to fulfill a certain role, and they give you power to do that, let's say they've asked you to become a boss, a manager, a CEO, a supervisor, a president, a head of organization, I mean, you name it. With that comes power. Now, the purpose of that power, ideally, is to be used for a good purpose, to mobilize and move things in a good direction. And when I say good direction, I mean the direction that will serve the best interest of the company, of the organization, of the people who have given you this power, the power of trust, of resources, of love, of loyalty, of following you, of confidence in you. All of that is supposed to be used to create more, a better reality for those who have entrusted you, who trusted you. Now, when you have so much power, when you're exercising leadership or authority, the power that comes with the contract in the case of it's an official authority, or the power that comes with the trust and the confidence and the love and the surrender, you know, that are giving you when you're exercising leadership, and it could be in both cases, you are holding something very precious in your hand. Now, that same power could be used in so many different ways. It's like a battery. Battery. You can use a battery to drive a truck that could be used for a good service. You can use it to drive, you know, start a tank, let's say, as an example, to wage war. When you have so much power, when you're exercising leadership or authority, you have huge potential in your hand, because you can do with that power so many things. You can be corrupt. You can use that power to serve in your interest instead of the interest of those who have given you this power. You can be corrupt. You can use that power to become a source of oppression, of tyranny, of abuse to the people who have authorized you. It's like people, I'll just give an extreme example. Like people have elected a government or elected an authority or a president or chose a king or whatever, and they've given that person or that government the authority to command the army, you know, to control the resources of the government, the money, the finances, you name it, the law, the whole thing. So all that is power. So what does the authority system or the person do in that case as a possibility? They use it instead of serving the people. What do? They use it to serve their own interest, and or they use it as a source of oppression. So they use the army to suppress people, to suppress opposition, right? To suppress, to create as an instrument of tyranny, of abuse, because the power is there. In organizations, it's the same thing. They give you power, so what do? They use the power for your own best interest, at the expense of that organization that has given you the power. Or people have, you know, people love you, they trust you, they follow you for whatever reason. And you use that power of love and trust and fellowship, that, you know, being followers to you, loyalty to you, that they've given to you, to for their own interest, by, you know, manipulating them, abusing them, you name it. So it's very easy for the power that could be used to create good to turn into evil and bad, and turn into tyranny and oppression and abuse. That's why it's famously said, power corrupt, absolute power corrupts absolutely. That's why in many constitutions and many systems, whether at the country level or organization level, the system itself has built-in mechanisms to make sure that power does not become, is not abused, does not become tyrannical, does not become oppressive, does not become abusive power. So they limit the power of the president by having powers in the parliament, by having power in the Supreme Court, they have, by distributing power in many places, so that they can have checks and balances, as they say. At the same time, organizations, they limit the power of the manager or the CEO by what? By having entities that supervise them, like the audit committee, like the auditors, external auditors. They come and check, internal auditors, who also check whether the policies and procedures internally are, you know, respected and fulfilled, and they report to a higher authority, the board of director, right? So all of these mechanisms are deliberately built in, because from experience, if there's one thing we've learned from history, human history at least, is that power could easily be abused for oppressive, tyrannical, and abusive and manipulative purposes. So it's very easy to fall into that trap, unless the right mechanism is built in. And listen carefully, it's very easy for you, if you are exercising leadership or authority, to fall into that trap, because you have your own hungers, your own weaknesses, your own insecurities, your own vulnerabilities. And it's very easy to fall into temptation of using this power to fulfill these hungers, to fulfill these, you know, negative psychological needs, if we can call them negative. So there's a trap also from your side. Now, what protects against all of this? Many things. Number one is the people themselves, who are under the subject of this tyrannical force, under the subject of this oppressive entity, abusive entity, manipulative entity. They also have power innate in them. They also carry power, and they can use that power to stand up against this tyrannical force, against this tyrannical entity, and say no, no to oppression, no to tyranny, no to abuse and manipulation, and enough is enough. And even to turn things around, you know, to either to stop that behavior or uproot the entire thing and kick these people out, or take away the power from them. Through revolution, through election, through so many other mechanisms, through the media, you name it. There's so many mechanisms people can do that. Within the organization itself, there are also mechanisms where you can do that. On a personal level, you can say no to abusive authority. You can say no, not acceptable. You can set your own boundaries. And there are mechanisms where you can, you know, use the system so that you can make these people stop that oppressive behavior, tyrannical behavior, abusive behavior. It's not easy. It's never easy to stand up to authority, because authority has resources, and because there's conflict involved, and because there will be cost, there might be blood, there might be hatred, there might be opposition, your boss might turn against you, authority might become, I don't know, violent, I mean, you name it. But you still have power, and if you don't use that power to stop authority being abusive, it will continue to abuse you. It's not only that, it will bully you, and it will, you'll be indirectly giving them permission to do more of that. Another process is to make sure that within the process itself there are protection mechanisms. So when in the government, in the constitution, there are protection mechanisms that will give you tools, give the country tools, so that authority does not become tyrannical or abusive or manipulative or oppressive. And it's the duty of the people to make sure that these are part of the system itself. Like, let's talk at the organization level. The bylaws, the internal governance, you know, rules and mechanisms, they have to include elements where the system can use these tools to prevent these tyrannical, you know, forces from exercising itself, oppression and abuse and corruption. There must be these tools that exist. Now, if you don't have these things, your own will, your own determination, your own courage to do whatever you need to do to stop abuse, corruption, oppression, tyranny, if you don't have these mechanisms built in, whether in your family, your organization, your department, your country, then I guarantee you, you will be abused, because history is very clear in that. It is very hard over time not to abuse power if you don't put the right mechanism in place. It's very hard. It takes people or systems or entities with such a strong value system, such a strong value system, internal value system that's so strong that could within itself, through the power of the values, through ethics, morality, and you name it, prevent itself from falling into the temptation of using power to become, you know, as a tyrannical or oppressive or manipulative or a corruptive force. But you can't rely on that, because you're asking too much. People are vulnerable. People have their own demons. People have their own shadows. People have their own weaknesses. Things change. People become, you know, weak over time. Fragile. It depends. We are human beings. The environment is always changing. Today you're strong. Tomorrow the temptation is so strong, you know, it becomes so tempting, so powerful, that you fall into this trap and you become, you start using or abusing the power that you have to become a tyrannical or corrupt or abusive force against other people. That dynamic will always be there. It is part of the reality of the space or the universe of authority, the space and the universe of leadership, of what a human being is all about. It's part of human nature. It will always be there. It has always been there and will continue to be there. So the challenge is, how do you protect yourself against this and make sure that you don't fall into this difficult and harmful reality? And unfortunately, many families, organizations, teams, departments, even countries have fallen into that, and so much unnecessary pain, loss of opportunities, resources, time, generations, opportunities are wasted because the system has turned oppressive, corrupt, and abusive. Just look around you. Start with families, maybe your own family, and cascade that into society in general, governments, and the whole international community. It's a very important question, very important dynamic. You have to understand it well from both sides. If you're exercising authority and leadership, you have to understand that in the first place, so that you don't fall into that temptation of abusing your power. And if you are from the other side, you have to understand it so that you don't end up being abused. If you don't understand this on both sides, huge problems are on the way. And that's part of the reality of life.
Thank you for listening to the Michael Cooley podcast. Please visit cooleyinstitute.com and send us an email. We would love to hear your comments and thoughts on this episode. And remember to follow Michael's continuous learning insights on social media.